It felt this very realistic looking Star Wars ship. It was supposed to be for kids several years older than my brother. The 20-something year old employee at the store told my mom it had taken him months to put it together. It was that complicated. Well, my parents were so excited to give it to my brother for Christmas. You see, he always put his Lego sets together so fast, and I thought, oh, this one will take him a while. Well, Christmas Day came, and my brother tore open the package, and he was, of course, thrilled. So much so that he went off to start building right away. And a few hours later, he came walking down the stairs, and he was holding the fully completed model. You know, he looked so proud at first that he had finished this model so much faster than that 20-year-old employee at the store. But then he got this look of sadness across his face. And my parents, of course, were concerned, and they said, well, what's wrong? Was this not what you wanted? Was it not what you hoped for? You see, he had followed all the directions for this very complicated Lego set meticulously. But now it was done. And I could tell there's something nagging at him, this question, is this really it? Isn't there more? Is this all there is to this? Have you ever felt that way? Have you ever completed a project, followed all the rules, worked really, really hard, acquired something new and flashy that you thought would satisfy some deep desire, only to wonder, okay, what's next? There has to be something more. There has to be some deeper satisfaction, right? Richard Rohr writes, when you have to have more and more of the same thing, it's probably not working. Now, Legos are one thing. But for most of us, it's the more substantial things in life. We think if we could just get more money, more security, then we'll be satisfied. Or sometimes even if I could just get a little more organized, if I could just do things a little more perfectly, if I could just add one more to-do item into that checklist for today, then I would be happier. And sometimes it's the list of things that we want less of. If I could just eat a little less healthy food. If I could just have a little less worry or a little less family drama. If I could just be on one less church meeting, then I would be happy. The young man in this story that Chris read for us this morning comes to Jesus with very much the same kind of longing and wondering. Isn't there more to life than this? He's wealthy. He has all of his basic needs met, and then some. He's followed all the rules. He's stayed away from all the do-nots, and he's checked off all the to-dos. And yet he still senses that something is missing. And he asks Jesus a very perplexing question. What must I do to inherit eternal life? Now, it's perplexing, of course, because of how he asks the question. He doesn't ask, what must I do to earn eternal life? He asks, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And I think perhaps without even realizing it, probably because he's inherited most things in his life, this wealthy young man intuits that God's love and God's welcome into eternal life with God is not something that you can earn. It's not even something you can do anything to achieve. But it's something that is freely given as a gift. I love Jesus' response to his question. After he asks him about whether he's been following the laws, and he says yes, Jesus looks at this man, and the story tells us he looks at him with love. Now, I want you to let that sink in for just a moment. That's often a part of the story that we just pass right over. And if you were sitting here and you were listening to Chris this morning read the scripture all about selling your possessions, and you were thinking, oof, gosh, I'm not sure I can do that. I think I might walk away sad, too. Then you need to hear this part of the story. Because Jesus loves this man from the very beginning of the conversation. It's not conditional. And selling all his possessions. That love, it's there from the beginning. But what Jesus knows, and what this man senses, is that even though eternal life with God is freely given or inherited, eternal life with God is also life in the kingdom. It's a life that begins right here, right now. And we have to live into and become kingdom people. That's where the doing part comes in. Becoming who we already are is my favorite phrase to describe this. Now, this man is probably not so different in age from Jesus' other disciples. And perhaps Jesus senses that this man literally does want to leave everything and come follow him the way the other disciples had, to learn from him as a rabbi. But of course, there's a lot more than fishing nets to drop and fathers to say goodbye to for this man. There probably was a great deal of responsibility and expectation that came with all of that inherited wealth that this young man has. And all of those expectations and responsibilities probably did not include taking off to follow a rabbi, particularly a self-made, self-taught, ragtag rabbi like Jesus. But something in this young man has drawn to Jesus nonetheless, just as something has drawn you here to this community, to this place, this morning. That desire for something more, and that hunch that Jesus might know how and where to find him. Now, why ask this young man to sell all of his possessions? We get the sense that this man did not feel able to do what Jesus was encouraging him to. However, there have been many across the ages who have succeeded in giving away their possessions. You may have heard of one of them, Anthony or Antony. He was a wealthy young man whose parents died when he was only 20 years old. And like many before him, Antony discovered in his grief that money doesn't buy happiness. So like the young man in our story, he one day is out walking and he hears a very similar passage to our story this morning. He hears a passage from Matthew being read. If you want to be perfect, go. Sell what you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And come, follow me. And he took it to heart. And he did. He sold all of his possessions. He gave to the poor. He devoted himself to a life of prayer. Or at least that's how the legend of St. Antony the Great goes, saint from the 3rd century. He's often heralded as the first monk or the first desert father. There were, of course, many more before him, but perhaps not as many with as much wealth or reputation or thought. The church was quick to saint him. They were quick to recognize him as a professional Christian. In fact, for a long time, that became the model for vocational Christians. selling all their possessions, detaching, living apart. That's what it meant to take the next step, to go to the next level of Christ following, extreme of Christ following, if you will. Now, many of you know that detachment is something that is valued by a lot of our world religions. Many of you who have studied religions probably know that Buddhism, for instance, teaches that it is our attachment to things and to people and even to emotions that causes our suffering, and so they teach detaching from the world. The Judeo-Christian tradition, which includes Judaism and Christianity and Islam, they have all taught something just a little bit different. They have taught that it is our attaching to the wrong things that causes our suffering, because they keep us from attaching to the good and the life-giving things, namely God or Jesus or the Spirit. And so saints like Antony left everything behind, and they headed out into the desert to connect deeply with God, to detach from everything except for God. But you know, as I was thinking about becoming or living into being kingdom people, I started to wonder what it would really feel like to live in a community that was modeled after the desert saints, where we're entirely disconnected from one another and connected solely to God. I personally believe Jesus meant to connect the young man in our story even more to his community, meant to break down the barriers of class and wealth that separated him from the rest. I think if detachment had been the sole goal when Jesus gave his instructions, Jesus would have just told the man, hey, go burn all of your possessions. But Jesus tells him to share them. And that's so characteristic of kingdom life. And that being able to share our possessions and share with one another is part of God, how God does the impossible in us. Have any of you seen that video that's floating around online right now of a bunch of ants? Any of you know what I'm talking about? Well, you probably know that South Carolina right now is experiencing some of the worst flooding that they've seen in 1,000 years. And of course, that's really bad news for little earth critters like ants. On their own, these ants can never survive. But the news cameras actually captured all of these little fire ants who had created a living life raft. They had used their claws and their jaws and the sticky stuff on their legs to get all interconnected with one another. And they had put the weakest and the queen and all of that at the center. And there they were floating along on top of the floodwaters, this big pile of fire ants. Now, even though I don't have any interest in being a fire ant, it is really a beautiful picture of kingdom of life, where we care for one another and where we recognize that our own survival depends on the others around us. So maybe the reason that Jesus instructs this man to give away all of his wealth and possessions is to teach him the value of detachment, how to solely rely on God. Or maybe it is to teach him this deeper connection and interconnection with his fellow humanity. Or maybe there's a third option. Maybe the whole point is to make him feel that it is just too hard to do this on his own. You know, Jesus uses this picture of a camel trying to fit through the eye of a needle to describe how incredibly hard it is to start living as kingdom people. Some of you, I'm sure, from past preachers have probably heard that the legend has it that there was a gate in Jerusalem that was called the Eye of the Needle. And And there is one today, although it hasn't been around long enough to have been there when Jesus was around. But even that, if it was anything like the gate that's currently there, it would have been way, way, way too small for a camel to fit through. The gate that's currently there is barely big enough for a small human to fit through. And maybe that's the point. You know, in my weekly e-letter that I sent out this week, I put a cartoon at the top. And the cartoon was of two businessmen standing there watching a camel try to fit through this giant needle eye. And the camel is clearly stuck and uncomfortable. And the two businessmen look at one another and they say, "Well, I guess we're just going to have to buy a bigger needle." Assuming that we can't just buy a bigger needle. The reality is that we need God not only to give us that free gift of an unearned welcome into kingdom life, but we also need God's help for the doing part, for becoming kingdom people. Friends, the good news, but also maybe the hard news for those of us who like to be very independent, is that even that part, even the becoming kingdom people, we don't do on our own. The Spirit moves in us, and the Spirit empowers us to live into who we already are in Christ, to become people who are held as beloved and who bear God's love to the world. God takes us, these impossible saints, and God looks at us with love, and God transforms us into priests and into saints. I love the conversation between Jesus and the disciples at the end of our passage today, where the disciples are suddenly very concerned that all of their sacrifices, of leaving their families behind, leaving their jobs behind, and coming to follow Jesus, that even that hasn't assured them a place in the kingdom. And so they ask Jesus about the possibility of their own lives. And Jesus' reply is that our God is a God of abundance and a God of blessing. And where we sacrifice and where we share of ourselves, God and our kingdom life together will make it blossom into something incredible, something beyond our wildest imaginings. You know, the disciples had left family behind to follow Jesus, and of course, we know that God will create out of those disciples a whole family, a whole community of Christ across the globe. They will have people to claim as brothers and sisters all over the place and all throughout the ages. And we know that the disciples left home, but that they become a part of building a new home with Christ as the cornerstone. And we know that they left fields and they left fishing nets, but that they have new fields to harvest, and that they become fishers of people. They cast out the net of God's love far and wide. And we know that they don't do this in some future heavenly realm, but that they begin doing it right here, right now, in their present time. They start to become and to live into those lessons of abundance right in the present moment. So friends, let us try as best as we are able to follow this radical way of life that Jesus lived more sacrificially each and every day, to share more of ourselves and more of our resources each day. And let us trust God, that God will do the impossible in us.